Hello. Welcome to another edition of the Mike Zielinski Show. I'm honored today to have as my guest Dr. Kenneth Hawkinson, who is the president of Kutztown University. We're here in his beautiful office in KU. Welcome.
Thank you, Mike. I'm delighted to be able to have a conversation with you today.
You know, it's interesting that you wound up being the president of Kutztown University, considering your very diverse background. You were the first member of your family to go to college. Then you went to community college while working in a tool and die manufacturing, and you wound up with a master's degree, a doctorate degree, a Fulbright scholar, Army infantry officer. You were a Peace Corps volunteer in Africa, and just amazing your track record. How has all that shaped your educational philosophy?
Well, many people asked me when I was interviewing for the job president, you know, how long did I prepare for the interview? And I said, from the day I was born.
That's a good answer. Yeah. No wonder you got the job.
And that's usually the case for people who go into presidencies of universities and probably other institutions as well. It's not always so much about what you know, although you have to have a certain level of knowledge, of course, and experience to be president of the university. But it's more about who you are as a person, and throughout the interview process, I was able just to explain who I was. And as you mentioned, you know, my background, and again, being first generation college, and even in, to a certain degree, one of the few to even finish high school, and my family, and when I started community college, I was working 70 hours a week. And
really?
I was not only at the tool and die shop, but I was delivering pizzas, and it was a very hard time of it, completely on my own and self-supporting.
What do you think your motivation was, considering that your family really wasn't that educationally oriented?
Yeah, my father had essentially been transferred to Minnesota. I grew up in the Chicago area, and I was just very inspired by my high school teachers. And I wanted to go to college. I had a hunger for it. I had a hunger for learning. I was very, very idealistic. And so I was just driven. I would be at the tool and die factory, and those were very long days. And then I went to work at the emergency room of a hospital in Elgin, Illinois. And I was an orderly and an EMT. At the hospital, and I would be at work at about 6:30 in the morning. Both jobs started at 7 and work till 4 or 5. I would go home. I would make a little spaghetti because that's all I ever ate back then, because that's all the money I had. And then off to night school, and then come home, study, and start all over again early
and
the next morning.
For about 20 minutes. Yeah. You can only do that when you're young, right?
I'm 62 years old, and I'm still trying to catch up on the sleep of those days.
I can imagine. You know, obviously, we want to talk about your Kutztown University, but just real quickly, your Peace Corps experience in Africa.
It was just amazing. I am old enough to remember Jack Kennedy, and
so am I.
And I was very inspired by the charge he gave all young people to serve your country and serve the world, and so I had that on my list of things I wanted to do. I served in the Army, but I also
was that before or after Peace Corps?
The Army was after my master's degree.
Okay.
And
that's during the Vietnam War, right?
I just missed it. Okay. I'm in the last year group to carry a draft card. I still have it. My brother was in Vietnam, who's older, and my uncle went to Vietnam, and my father was active duty military during Vietnam. But I very much wanted to go into the Peace Corps. So when I finished my doctorate degree in 1986, I went right into the Peace Corps, and I got an assignment as a college professor at a teacher's college in Mali, in West Africa. Most people don't know where Mali is, but they've heard of Timbuktu.
I was in
Timbuktu. And I taught at a teacher's college after about 4 months of training, where I actually lived in a village in a hut with a family, and did language training and and other types of orientation in those
languages. What language do they speak there?
The language of government and education is French, but the local ethnic language was Bambara. And
you had to learn that?
Primarily I was studying French, but I also had to learn the basics of Bambara so I can get by in a marketplace and to have basic greetings and, you know, very simple exchanges.
You could pull it off, though. You were a Fulbright scholar. Right?
Well, that came later.
Oh, okay.
But I do have to tell you about that Bambara. A close friend of mine almost won a car because of that. He was playing Trivia Pursuit with his brother-in-law, and one of the questions is, what language is the primary language in Mali? And my friend said, Bambara. And his brother-in-law said, if you get this one right, I'll give you my car. And he couldn't believe it.
That's amazing.
Yeah, it's a funny story. But but he didn't take the car. But he could have.
Yeah.
It was an incredible experience to be there and as a Peace Corps volunteer. And I learned the lesson that all Peace Corps volunteers learn, and that the benefit is more to you as an individual and what you bring back.
Yeah.
Than what you give. I felt I made a contribution, you know, working with all my students. But every day I think back to that Peace Corps experience and to my Army experience and to my education and
that's kind of
various other experiences.
How do you think that shaped your educational philosophy?
I think it's made me very calm about most things in life. I believe the boundaries of my experiences have been vast, and so not a lot shocks me. And particularly some of the different ways in which we look at the world between here and where I was in West Africa. Westerners think of time, for example, it's very linear. You know, 1 year follows another, and so on and so forth. Where I was in West Africa, the way time is thought of is more circular. Most people think of time as going back to grandparents, maybe great-grandparents, and they extend forward to grandchildren, maybe great-grandchildren, and there's not a whole lot that exists before or will exist beyond that. And so it's this whole kind of different concept of looking at the world. I believe it's a much more integrated way I look at things, perhaps, because of my experiences. I know a little bit about a lot of things. I may not know a lot about a single thing, but
you're
that served me well.
All right, speaking of when your time, let's fast forward. We're here in Kutztown University. Some challenges with enrollment here, right?
Yes.
Moving away from a teaching school to a degree, has that impacted that, or are there other forces at work?
Mm-hmm. Well, there's a number of things that impacted enrollment. The largest is just demographics. The number of 18-year-olds peaked in around 2010, 2011. And this is nationwide, and
yeah, I understand it's not just Kutztown.
Yeah, and we were about 10,707 students.
You have that memorized. That's right.
I may have picked that up somewhere along the way, and there was a steady drop of 300-500 a year every year. When I arrived, there were 9,000 students exactly. And
you've had some initiatives to increase that. And what are you up to coming into this year?
We started this past year at 8,329 students, and we all are working so hard to get 8,330 students. If we're up even one student, it's going to be a really great turnaround and great success. But it could go 50 either way. We're now at the very end of this process, and you know, each day I look at the numbers very anxiously. And even if it turns out we're down a few students, it'll still be a very successful year because we've stopped that really bad drop that was coming every year. But along with the fact that there's been demographic changes, and they're not likely to change. There's not supposed to be an uptick in 18-year-olds for another 7, 8, 9 years. But there's also been an increase in competition. Pennsylvania is amazing. There are 160 schools in Pennsylvania that offer four-year degrees. It's the most, I believe, as any other state.
Really? I didn't realize that.
160. And it seems, you know, every other town has a college. And a lot of that's because of when Pennsylvania was settled, you know, by the different religious groups and others. I mean, what does a religious group do? They build a college, and then that just continues as you go across the state. And so there's a lot of local competition, but then there's competition online from a lot of these national, like Phoenix or other schools that are offering these online programs.
I guess I'm old-fashioned. I kind of think a college education should be bricks and mortar, but anyway.
So do I.
The fact that the state schools, such as Kutztown University, are a much more affordable option than private institutions where the cost of attendance is astronomical in some cases, you would think, just for economic reasons, parents would encourage their kids to go to a state school. You know?
Yes, I completely agree, and we just completed our sesquicentennial celebration. That was 2 years ago, and we were founded in 1866, and so in 2016 is 150 years. That coincided with the community of Kutztown, the borough of Kutztown, celebrating their bicentennial. And so this was a really exciting time, and I came in and had my inauguration at the sesquicentennial. And one of the things that I know I really wanted to emphasize and others was the traditional roots of the university, that we recruited students in the past, you know, from the farms, from the mills, from the coal mines, many of them first generation. And this was a school that gave a traditional education in a beautiful, beautiful setting. And
you've added a lot of amenities in the last few years, right? In terms of what people, students can eat and relax.
That's one of the challenges that we have to deal with now. All universities must deal with that are residential universities. Is there's much higher expectations, many higher expectations on the part of students and their parents. When I went to college, you just shared a very simple room with someone else. Now students more and more, you know, I'm one of five children. Many students coming to us are single children or one of two or one of three. I shared my bedroom growing up with two brothers. So there are three of us, seven in the house, one bathroom. Kids or young people now, they want their own room. They want access to a bathroom or at least a semi-private bathroom. And so all our new residence halls are suites, apartment style buildings. The freshman, you know, halls are still more traditional, but there's an expectation for air conditioning to be able to eat. Like we have 24/7 dining, which is unbelievable.
I know, I saw that in the paper, I guess, and I couldn't believe that. But the thing is, it's important though, because there's an academic tie-in to that, is there not? Because I know you now require students to hopefully, so they complete and get their degrees, to live on campus for the first 2 years, correct? Yeah. I mean, obviously you can have commuters, but
yes.
That makes sense because less distractions, you know?
Yes, we've looked at all the data, and there's a significantly higher increase in retention from freshman to sophomore year for those who live on campus compared to those who don't. And what we're actually doing as a service to landlords and apartment complexes off campus, because when the students as juniors go off campus, they're going to be more mature and ready to be able to, you know, be productive citizens of the borough.
And that helps that relationship, because I know in the past there have been some frictional moments, I guess.
Yes.
Which all college towns have. You know.
Yes. Yes, and so we think it's going to be a much better experience for our students if they stay on campus for the first 2 years, and truly that is our intention: higher retention rates, higher graduation rates. That's really what we want by instituting that 2-year requirement. And a lot of the private schools require their students to be on campus for two, sometimes three or four years, and we're kind of following their lead on this.
Now, all this takes money, and you've had some budget challenges, right? Mm-hmm. And as the president, that's your major focus of your job, right?
And you've really been aggressive.
You've been very aggressive going after dollars. How's it working out for you?
Well, it's going well. There are some things under our control and some things not under our control. We're delighted that the legislature and the governor provided what for us will be a 3.6% increase in our state allocation, state appropriation. We don't like seeing tuition go up, of course, but we're desperate for resources, and we're very happy that the state and the Board of Governors put in place the 2.99% increase in tuition. But those things, while we lobby for these things, they're not under our direct control.
Yeah.
But under our control would be building more efficiency into our budget, and we've been cutting quite drastically to ensure that we have a balanced budget. And we've also had to adjust some fee structures and raise some student fees to also help cover our expenses. And with all these things happening together, this coming year will be the first year in, I believe, 7 years that we will have a true balanced budget wherein we don't rely on pulling reserves to make the difference. So this will be the first year in 7 years where the income into the university will match the expenditures.
That's very encouraging.
Yeah, and so we're very excited that we've met this threshold.
Now, you've been on the job 3 years, and you've had a lot of initiatives, I believe 53 of them.
Yes.
And focused on so many things. I have them scrolled down here somewhere, but focusing on academic excellence, enrollment management, student success, and expanding educational opportunities and access, including you're becoming more internationally diverse. You just had an agreement with, is it Symbosis?
Symbiosis.
Okay. College in India?
Yes, it's a consortium of colleges, and that's one of the colleges there.
So they can come here, and will your students go there? Is it a two-way street?
It's a two-way street, and we're looking at summer programs as well where they can go for 6 weeks. And I just met this morning with the director of our international studies area and the vice president of that area about other initiatives. Traditionally we were a college that served this region of the state of Pennsylvania, you know, a little bit into New Jersey perhaps. But now we really have to be ready to put our students out into the whole world and bring the whole world
and
to our
campus. And you're
literally
doing that, correct?
Yes, I think we've got a good start on it.
You have 100 international students from 30 different countries.
Yeah.
I mean, when I saw that really surprised me because I think of the traditional Kutztown.
Yeah.
With teaching not being just a teaching school anymore, what are your more popular majors here at Kutztown?
Yeah, the strongest or the largest majors are business administration, psychology, communication, social work. I think those would probably be the largest areas. Criminal justice is a very large major.
Well, that's interesting because that was kind of has been Alvernia's bailiwick. I don't know if it still is, but at one time they had a pretty.
Yeah, nationwide, criminal justice is a large major. It's a popular field that a lot of young people want to go into. Criminal justice.
I guess part and parcel of the changes here, you started a whole new rebranding of Kutztown University.
Yes.
So tell me a little bit about that.
Well, indeed, we wanted to celebrate our background and who we were and where we came from. And so we hired a nationally known company, a marketing company, and they went to work, and thousands of people were surveyed and hundreds of people were interviewed, and I spent a lot of time with the creative talent of this company, and I was very impressed with what they came up with in helping us, because I believe it really nailed who we were. And we have some promotional materials out that talk about the type of people that go to Kutztown. They have grit. They're tough. Again, they're from the mines. They're from the farms. They're from the mills. They're from urban areas now. They're young people who traditionally have not had things handed to them. They've had to work for it. They don't look for flash. They look for validation. So these are some of the things that we try to bring out, that this is sort of a, you know, a school where people were really able to rise and to have a different life for themselves. And this is what we're emphasizing to, you know, our students now. The overall tagline is, it's good to be golden.
Yeah, well, that, you know, you see the signs here, you know, and you have the perfect school nickname, Golden Bears, to play off that. But it is. And, you know, even with rising tuition and services, I mean, if students and parents look at it, I mean, education is an investment in your future. Mm-hmm. And if you don't have that, you know, unless you really have a very good technical job, your income throughout your life is going to really suffer. So I think people have to look at the long term.
Yeah, our basic tuition rate is about $7,700. That's extraordinarily low compared to most other schools, with the exception of the community colleges. And it's a great deal, a great investment. I mean, if you add fees and then you add housing and dining, it becomes more expensive. But the basic rate is for a four-year school is about as low as you can get.
Oh yeah.
And we're getting more and more out-of-state students because we've discounted tuition for out-of-state. And in terms of the overall investment, we all know the statistic: the average person who has a college degree will make $1 million more through the course of their career than someone who doesn't have a college degree, and that is a significant difference.
Well, no question. And you've also you increased academic standards, you increase in academic profile, so it makes you more attractive, I think, to a lot of parents and students who are saying, you know, we're just not going to a state school. You are a state school, but you know, academically, you're...
Yeah, we want to make sure that students who come here have, you know, a really good, honest chance of being able to succeed. And that means that we do want to take in students who have shown that they're prepared for college. And if they're not, a good place for them to start is a community college. I went to a community college, so
and you have transfer,
we have transfer agreements with our
RAC,
regional.
And a lot of other community colleges, right?
Yes, and then if they start there and maybe even part-time and they establish that they can succeed, you know, then we're just delighted if they can come over and join us. But there's nothing worse than to start college and to not succeed. It's something that, you know, that someone has to carry with them their whole life, and we don't, you know, we want to make sure everyone who comes here has a chance to make it the whole way.
One other thing I thought was interesting, you have established numerous advisory committees because you have a commitment to shared governance.
Yeah, governance, yes.
Hard for me to say. But anyway, tell me a little bit about that.
Well, I have a faculty advisory committee, and every vice president does. Human resources has a committee. I have a town gown committee. My wife has a town gown committee to advise her because she plays such an important role at the university and in the community. There are other groups that are set up, and these groups are just essential to make sure that we're getting feedback in terms of these initiatives and the things that we're doing. I don't have all the ideas, and neither do the other vice presidents and leaders of the university. And it's, you know, inclusiveness, working together, being able to bounce ideas off others is just standard good practice, best practice.
And it gets everybody kind of invested to a larger degree.
Yeah. Yes. And it's all a part of the whole experience that we've talked about. I've talked about it at my inauguration and in many of my speeches and in my everyday conversation. I go back to what college did for me as a young person, and I, you know, I so strongly want that same experience to happen to young people who come here. And basically, college is here to awaken young people, to kind of, again, to wake them up, to make them see things a little differently than they ever had before. It's to make them curious, to read that new book, to do that new experiment, to try that new recipe, or to listen at new music. It's to help them solidify their value system that they would have already gotten from their parents, their church, you know, their friends. And then it's to instill in them a sense of gratefulness and humility that will serve them the rest of their life. That's what college did for me, and that's what I'm hoping that we can do for young people.
Yeah, and it sounds like you are doing that. You know, for those of us who have been fortunate enough to go to college, it's the best 4 years of your life.
It is.
Or five if you take your time.
Yeah. Or ten if you go for a doctorate degree.
You know, I only have like a minute and a half, and this may be unfair, but you also have a vision of Kutztown University as the cultural center of the mm-hmm. region. Can you sum that up in 65 seconds? Or
I'll try. And we're very excited about the role that we play. Being a medium-sized university in a small town is such a gift for, mm-hmm. for everyone involved. The local community can come here for concerts, for speakers. We have our KU Presents series where we have...
Oh, that's a remarkable series. Yeah.
Yes. We're now starting a fine arts... organization of interested volunteers and donors that will help us provide programming for children throughout the region, pay for their busing from schools, and bring in acts and performances for young people. We have the planetarium. We have the German American Cultural Center.
I didn't realize that the expansiveness of it all.
There's so much more, but the community offers so much to us as well. You cross the street and you're in a beautiful, beautiful town with wonderful restaurants and wonderful people.
Well, hey, it's a great place to go to school. And we thank you for your time, Dr. Hawkinson, and best of luck with the future. And it was very nice meeting you.
Thank you so much, Mike.
For now, Mike Slinsky saying take care.